Hi, I'm Ed Knight, president of Theater 3, and I'd like to welcome you to another edition of Welcome to the Theater. This time you'll be meeting some of the actors from A Christmas Carol. The show goes up on December 6th, and it runs for that weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and the next weekend as well, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, that's December 13th, 14th, and 15th. The afternoon performances are on the Sundays. For ticket information, you can go to the theater website, which is theater3.org, theatre.org, or call 978-263-9070. Interviewing now Sabrina Hildreth, who is playing the ghost of Christmas Present. What's it like playing a ghost?
It's really fun because you can have sort of over-the-top arm movements and a very over-the-top voice and just, you know, a very extravagant presence on stage. And if there's one thing anyone who knows me well will tell you, it's that I'm a very extravagant person in generally real life. So it's very fun to sort of play with that on stage.
Have you ever played a ghost before?
I do not think I've ever played a ghost before, no. No, I don't think so. Except maybe at a haunted house I was working at once. But aside from that, no.
How did you get started in the theater? What was your first show?
Well, my first show that I really acted in, I did a couple church plays, but I didn't really do much aside from like background stuff. Uh-huh. But the first thing I ever had a role in was in Harvard with Superstar Productions when I was in fourth grade, when I was eight, and they were doing Anne of Green Gables, and I always wanted to be on stage, so I convinced my mom to let me, join, and so I went to the audition, and, it was my first ever show, so I was very nervous, so I decided, all the little girls are going to try to play Anne, so I'm just going to try for Diana, set the bar low, go in with low expectations, that can only lift, so she had separated all the girls into those who had heard the audition song and those who hadn't. And me being my dramatic little self had separated myself into my own category of those who had memorized the song.
Oh, jeez.
So we sang our audition songs, and after I sang my song, the director just looked at me and she said, "Are you sure you don't want the part of Anne?" And I was sort of just like, well, okay, I'm open to anything, You could have me play a tree, I'd be totally fine. So I went home, and 3 days later, we got the call, we'd like to offer you the part of Anne. And I was like, okay.
Wow.
Yeah, so, and, I was nervous about, memorizing all my lines and everything, but I don't remember much of it, because again, I was, eight.
Yeah.
But my mom tells me, you didn't memorize your lines. You memorized the entire show. So I'm like, that kind of sounds like me.
Kids that age, their minds are like sponges.
I just directed
Anne of Green Gables last year, and amazed. I had two ages of and because I had two age groups for the show, for Act 1, Act 2.
Mm-hmm.
And the younger Anne, I'd sit there and I'd give her a whole bunch of notes, and she wouldn't write anything down. And I'm like, is she going to remember all this? And sure enough, the next time, boom, everything. Whereas the adults, they're all busy writing down everything to make sure that they remember it. What led you to come out for this show?
It's actually also kind of another funny story. I had vaguely heard of Theater 3. I had been doing productions with Open Door Theater for a few years, since high school, on and off. So I had heard of them, basically, because, it's a very similar area they work around Acton.
Yeah.
But I'd never really, known anything in depth about Theater 3 until I was scrolling through Facebook events that are suggested to me, looking for fun stuff my mom and I can do. We like to go to a lot of things together.
Yep.
And I stumbled upon, it was a Tuesday between the two auditions that I stumbled upon this. I stumbled upon the audition listing for A Christmas Carol. And I was like, this looks really fun. I might have to think about that. And then I'm like, it's tomorrow. Okay, I have to think about that fast. Okay, so I saw it and I was like, I'll go for it. Worst that could happen is, a theater group I've never worked with before says no. So that's, not a huge deal. So I think I spent, one of the audition parts was obviously to sing a part of A Christmas Carol of your own choosing. So I think I was, I discovered all this while I was at work. So I think I spent a little while, you know, well, a long while at work singing different Christmas carols, seeing what sounded good, what I could remember quite easily. So I think I drove some of my coworkers a little crazy.
I guess
with
so.
That.
This was like, what, September?
Yeah, yeah. So they're like, oh gosh, are you gonna, if you get in the play, are you going to keep doing this? I'm like, well, I mean, maybe. And they're like, oh, Sabrina. But they're kind of used to it. I sing pretty much every day at work to the radio. Oh, so they're like, oh, geez, okay.
Well, thank you very much. Good. Thanks. Now I'm interviewing Ben Hart. Tell us about what part you're playing in the show.
Well, I'm playing Fred, who's Scrooge's nephew. So I get to be very cheerful and positive all the way through with, you know, trying to needle Scrooge into having a better attitude about Christmas and hoping against hope that he's going to reform. And then I get to be really surprised when he does in the end.
What led you to audition for this show?
Well, I moved to the area just recently, so I had been living closer to the city, and I'd done a little bit of theater in the last few years, having gotten back into it. Prior to that, I'd been off for about 20 years.
Wow.
So, yeah, it'd been a long time. My wife, from the time that she met me, actually, like, theater had been a really big part of my life up to that point. Uh-huh. And then until I was in a production of West Side Story recently, she had never seen me on stage, so
wow.
It was kind of a weird, it was a weird thing. But, you know, we moved to the area recently, and it seemed a good opportunity to give it a try.
How'd you get started in the theater?
Well, I started early on. I started when I was in, my school did a play when I was in kindergarten, and my first line ever was, E is for eggplant. We were doing, making alphabet soup. And then my third grade teacher always put on a play each year, and I was the big villain in that, and it made it really hard because I was supposed to be really mean, but I kept smiling the entire time.
So this part's perfect. Now you get
yeah.
If only you could have played this role
smile, yeah.
in third grade, you would have been all set.
Exactly. Yeah. I did it all through high school. I interned at a theater down in Rose Valley, Pennsylvania, Hedgerow Theater. It's a sort of an old repertory theater there, and you know I thought that this was going to be you know a big part of my life, and then. You know, then life happened and things changed. So it was, it took a while. I took a long time off, but started getting back into it a few years ago. I was in West Side Story as Lieutenant Trank with Moonstruck Theater. And then since then, I was Claudio in Much Ado About Nothing with Belmont Dramatic Club. And then the last show I was in before this one, I was William Detweiler in How the Other Half Loves by Hovey Players. So that was a great experience, and this has been a lot of fun.
I know you're a singer also, and did you study voice or did you just like learn it on the
I
fly?
I was a boy soprano.
Wow.
I was a boy soprano.
Uh-huh.
I can't quite hit the C above high C anymore.
Did you play a mal? It seems like most boy sopranos.
I did not. One of the other people in my choir did.
Okay.
But no, I was. So the choir master at the church was, his name was John Bertolo.
Uh-huh.
He came over from Blackburn Cathedral. He'd been the organist there, and then he ran the choir, and you know, was also involved with like Westminster Choir College in Princeton. And he was, he had been a protege of Benjamin Britten. Benjamin Britten, one of his operas, Midsummer Night's Dream, was going to be part of the New Jersey Opera Festival, and so that a number of the boy sopranos in that were recruited for that. So I got to be on stage for that, and we got a very favorable write-up from the New York Times, which was pretty specifically calling out the boy sopranos for that. So.
Was it traumatic when your voice started to change? Was there like a year or so?
Resistant to like letting that happen. I kept trying to sing the boy soprano part.
Yeah.
It was a little bit difficult because I was I was in eighth grade when it was happening, and I was trying to maintain like singing in that choir and also going to school and singing at that school. And the, you know, the parts for the boys, they're like, the highest part was tenor. So I was going between singing tenor and singing soprano, and then it was a bit confusing.
Right.
But I couldn't keep that up.
That happened to me in ninth grade, and I had been in a barbershop group, and I was like out for mm-hmm. like a year. There was just no way mm-hmm. my voice would crack. And so, it's traumatic if you really like to do it and all of a sudden you can't.
Yep.
And you're young enough, so you just don't really appreciate that a year isn't all that long.
But. Yeah.
So was there ever anything really crazy that happened to you on stage that you want to share?
Let's see. There was, in high school, we were in a production of Twelfth Night, and we were on stage in the middle of a performance, and then all of a sudden the lights went down.
Oh.
Just like complete black.
Wow.
And the person who was talking at the time knew to just keep going. And just kept going with her line, and it happened to be something about darkness. And so it worked out really well, and then the lights came back on, and we just sort of plowed on. Yeah. We found out later that the person who was running the light board had sort of...
knotted off.
Well, no, had been... he, you know, inadvertently knocked the light switch and just shut Oops. Everything down. Not ideal. Okay. But yeah, that was kind of fun.
How did you hear about this audition? For this show?
Well, I keep an eye on some of the audition uh-huh. boards. Uh-huh. You know, there's a website yep. That has a uh-huh. sort of collates a bunch of these. Yep. And so I was sort of keeping an eye for, you know, ones that looked interesting.
Good.
So.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Oh, my pleasure.
I'm interviewing Bill Horman, who is not a stranger to Welcome to the Theater. Because he's done other shows with us at Theater 3. Bill, tell us about how you first got involved with the theater.
Oh, dear. In 1968, in high school in Alexandria, Virginia, they were doing a performance of You Can't Take It With You, and they were short one actor. After searching the, 550 kids in the senior class, they finally asked me if I would do it, and I agreed, and... started my downfall, I guess, as far as theater goes.
And I understand you do opera as well.
Yes, I've been singing the past several years with Opera 51 as a fundraiser for 51 Walden in Concord. And the most recent thing we did was Carmen. And it's been a lot of fun.
Do you like to go to opera also, or are you more a performer than a watcher?
I like it, but strangely enough, Boston is not a great opera city.
Yeah.
So we've been to some of the Boston Lyric Opera productions, but not in a number of years. Too far to go. Uh-huh.
So tell us how you came to audition for this show.
Oh, well, there is scarcely a Theater 3 production that I won't audition for. Uh-huh. And anything that has to do with Charles Dickens, I'm all in. He's a remarkable writer with a very interesting life, and a lot of his life shows up in what he writes, including Christmas Carol.
What parts are you playing in this show?
I'm playing Marley's ghost and the ghost of Christmas future. So this theater season, I've played a person who dies during the performance. I've played a person who's dead at the beginning of the performance, for which I received rave reviews in the... in the Fitchburg Sentinel. Uh-huh. It was noted that Bill Horman sat in a wheelchair for the first 20 minutes of the show without moving a muscle. So.
And you didn't fall asleep?
Did not fall asleep, nor did I sneeze.
So have you been cast in the past as ghosts or deceased people? Or
no, this has just been a stroke of
unusual luck that you've done that. My stepdaughter at first, when she was first doing theater, kept playing dead bodies because she could be easily moved from place to place because she was small. And so, you know, she would be like the dead body in the window seat and could be lifted out and moved, and no one would be wondering how that person who was deceased had suddenly shrunk because the lights would be mostly down.
Yeah. So. Well, luckily I was in a wheelchair, so I could just be wheeled off the stage as a dead body rather than having 30 or 40 people try and lift me up and carry me away.
So have there ever been any really crazy things that have happened to you on stage? Or that you
yeah, unfortunately, the craziest thing was about 2 years ago. I was in a production, and there was it was a farce, and there was a staged fight. Mm-hmm. And in the excitement and exuberance of that activity, I got kind of twisted sideways and blew out my knee. So it was a ACL replacement and an MCL. It was exciting. I did not make the last scene.
Wow. Did somebody come on with a book? And
the director came running downstairs. He said, you sat down on stage. You've never done that before. Mm. I said, well, I can't stand up. I was able to hop off the stage. I said, I can't stand up. My knee has no stability. Yeah. And the director said, well, can you go out for the last scene? I said, no. The last scene was supposed to run across the stage and back again. I will not be hopping. So he grabbed my costume, went out, and an amazing cast. They picked up the pieces and got through the final scene.
Wow.
Good for them.
I've gotten hit in the nose one time. One of the problems in community theaters, they don't have, oftentimes they don't have a person who does staged fights.
Yeah.
And that can be hazardous, you know, sword fights and nobody's taught them how to do that, or you know, fisticuffs and nobody's told them how to do that safely.
Lesson learned.
Yes.
Fighting coaches are worth their weight in baklava.
Right. I've had shows where I got slapped a number of times because nobody knew how to do a slap that was a stage slap. And you can kind of get your bell rung.
Yeah, absolutely.
So. So do you have a role that you've always wanted to do that's like in the future, or do you keep
I can't think of any. Okay. I guess in my wildest dreams, there can't be any better part for an older person than King Lear, but I don't think that's happening.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thanks, Ed.
And now I'm interviewing Elizabeth Horman, who is also not only in the show, but is our costumer. What roles are you playing in the show?
In the show, I play three roles: Mrs. Fezziwig, the Undertaker, and the Charity Woman. All three very different roles.
Have you ever been in Christmas Carol before?
I haven't. Uh-huh. I was really excited when Theater 3 was going to do Christmas Carol. It's such a wonderful story, and it's one of those plays that it's for all ages, for the whole family, and I just thought, oh, what a fun thing to do in December.
How did you get your start in the theater? What was your first?
Oh, wow, my start in the theater. I didn't really do much real theater until I was an adult.
Okay.
So I took an acting class at Indian Hill Arts.
Uh-huh. What was that like?
Oh, that was fun. Uh-huh. It was acting for singers. Which was good.
Yeah.
So we did little vignettes and little, you know, pair people up and do things. But we did a lot of theater games to start, like how to walk different ways. Uh-huh. We also did one-word dialogues, where you had a list of words and paired two people up. The director paired two people up and gave you a scenario, and the only words you could use were the words on that page in the order in which they were listed, and one at a time.
Wow.
So you would have a word and I'd have to come back. And it was to teach you all about expression and tone and how you can change the meaning of a word through how you deliver it.
Yep.
And, you know, and the actions then, the physical actions that you put with it in order, and you created these little vignettes. And we did them for each other in the class. It was really interesting to see the choices that people made.
Years ago, I took an acting for singers class, and the only thing I remember from it was I was cast as a tree. And so there wasn't a whole lot of acting. And the next time I appeared with live trees, I was the Tin Man in the Wizard of Oz, and the trees were throwing apples at me. So at least they had something to do anyway.
Well, you know, you never know what you're going to end up doing in a play. And I think that's one of the fun things about auditioning. Sometimes you audition for a role and you're offered something totally different you hadn't even considered. And that actually is fun.
Yes.
And sometimes you're not offered anything because they have lots of people to choose from.
Right.
And people say, how many auditions have you gone to and you haven't been cast in anything yet? It's like, well, it happens.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know, it's just, you have to fit the part. And every director has a vision of what they're looking for.
Yeah.
And sometimes you don't match that vision.
Right. I've been in shows where they would just put you up on stage as couples and look to see if the couples looked right. So it didn't. There was nothing you could do because you didn't look like the right match for that person that you were on the stage with. They weren't going to cast you.
I've been told I'm not tall enough.
Yeah.
I am short. I know that. Yeah. I'm just over 5'1". Uh-huh. And I've been told that, boy, you had a really good audition, but you're not tall enough for the person you're going to play on stage with.
And you weren't going to grow for the
And I can't get any taller at this age. In fact, I'm shrinking, but it's okay. Yes. As people age, they shrink. Yeah. But, you know, so sometimes you just don't get something, and it's like, well, it's a disappointment, but it's a good life experience. Good.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I hope you've enjoyed the interviews of a few of our actors. If you'd like to see more of that and hear more of that, please go online and pick up some tickets to see our show. It's the It's 2 weekends starting on December 6th. So it's 6, 7, 8, and 13, 14, 15. And the Sunday shows are matinees. Tickets are available online at theater3.org, which is theatreiii.org, or by dialing 978-263-9070. Hope to see you there.